The Sports Junkies podcast is presented by PenFed Credit Union. PenFed's got great rates for those in uniform and those who are not. Apply today at PenFed.org. To receive any advertised product, you must become a member of PenFed, insured by NCUA.
Welcome back, Junkies on 106.7 The Fan. It's Bish, Cakes, and JP running the three-man show today. And we are brought to you by our friends at Crop Metcalf, the official heating and cooling company of the Junkies. Looking to be their next five-star HVAC technician or plumber, just visit cropmetcalf.com to join their team. Coming up in an hour, we got Ryan Zimmerman, who re-signed with the Washington Nationals. He'll be in that role player, pinch hitting, occasional first baseman role. So we will talk to Ryan Zimmerman in an hour. But join us right now on the Mattress Warehouse Hotline. It's our pal John Feinstein, best-selling author, Washington Post columnist. He's brought to you by Golfdom. Golfdom has everything you need to enjoy a great year of golf in 2021. Whether it's new clubs, winter gear to keep you warm, or push carts, Golfdom has it all. Just visit golfdomgolf.com or their store in Tysons. Golfdom, live the game. Good morning, John.
Good morning, everybody. Boy, is today a day to get some warm clothing for golf.
That is
oh
true.
Oh, my God. Hey, we know it was miserable yesterday.
John, we know
that with the wind, it was terrible yesterday. You're right.
Would your brother brave this this weather? He would go out and play in this sort of weather.
Right now.
He would, really? Really? He would play in this?
He might, yeah. He might. I mean, I've always said Bobby only plays golf on days that end in Y. he will play in almost anything. And so will his sons, who are both good players, both playing college golf right now.
Wow. Yeah, one of them's playing in William & Mary. Where's the other playing?
Right. The other one's at Rollins.
Rollins down in
the
Florida.
The freshman, right. Yeah, which has been a good golf school for a long time. So they are the golfing members of our family. I'm the hacker member of the family.
So, John, since Washington was bounced out of the playoffs and you had that Taylor Heinicke game, which everybody had fun watching him, the biggest subject of discussion in this town has been, well, what are they going to do at quarterback next year? You can kind of give us more of a historical perspective on things about it, but it's just a great debate that's been going on really for years and years.
Yeah, you're right. It's been a revolving door of quarterbacks here for a long time, really, going back almost to the Joe Gibbs era when he won three Super Bowls with three different quarterbacks. Mm-hmm. He won one with Theismann, one with Doug Williams, and one with Mark Rippon. But the thing about this year that is different than others is there are going to be so many quarterbacks moving. I mean, if I was Washington right now, mm-hmm. I would do whatever I had to do and try to get Deshaun Watson. Deshaun Watson's a star. I mean, you make a trade for him, he's going to be your quarterback for the next 10 years. He's going to be a Pro Bowl quarterback. To me, he's one of the best five or six quarterbacks in football, and he tends to get lost because his team was so bad this year. Remember last year they were in the playoffs and lost that game to Buffalo that he almost stole. They won that game at Buffalo against Buffalo, which they did steal, yeah. And made it to the second round. And he would be the hardest to get. You'd have to give up the most to get him. You can probably get Matthew Stafford relatively cheap, maybe a first rounder, maybe a second and a third. And I think he would be a good guy. I think he could be your starting quarterback for the next 3 or 4 years. He's going to be 33 next season. Quarterback, I mean, look at Brady, but most quarterbacks play into their mid-late 30s if they stay healthy. But there are plenty of options is my point. I think what you do is you keep Alex Smith around if he wants to play, for sure. Think of him as a very solid backup. And try and go out and get a guy who can be your clear-cut starter. And you're not going to get somebody in the draft unless you give up a lot. Trading up is hard because you give up so much when you trade up. So I'd go after either a trade or a free agent quarterback. And there are plenty out there.
Have you talked to Alex?
I have not talked to Alex for a long time. So I have no clue what he's thinking now.
Would you feel comfortable calling him and just say, hey, off the record, what are you thinking about doing? Would you feel comfortable doing that?
Maybe, but I honestly think right now his answer would be I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I really think that you know, he's talking to Elizabeth. He's got a thing. He's got young kids, as you guys know. He loved being able to prove everybody wrong by coming back and playing pretty effectively. And what was the record when he started? It was really good. 4-1, 5-1, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that meant a lot to him, that his career didn't end being carted off the field with his leg in 47 pieces. But whether he wants to go through the physical regimen that you have to go through to play in the NFL, regardless of position, I honestly don't know.
Hey, one of your recent tweets, shifting topics, was about the pace of play. I can't even remember what tournament it was. It was
last week,
like
Bob Hope.
A round going over 5 hours. I just kind of wanted to hear you rant about pace of play in golf.
Well, it's ridiculous. I don't know how much you guys watch golf on television. I watch a lot of golf on television, especially the last 10 months when I haven't been out of tournaments. And it's not as difficult to watch on television as if you're out there instead of walking with a group when it's just one group, because they can switch. You know, when a guy's walking around a putt 43 times, they can go to another hole where a guy's ready to hit. But even so, as you get toward the end, when there's only a few players on the course, it's torturous. I mean, these guys, you know, they mark, they pick the ball up, they mark again, they walk around it, they take it. And I'm not even talking about Bryson DeChambeau, who should be, you know, timed with a sundial. And Jay Monahan, who I think is a used car salesman, keeps saying, oh, no, pace of play is not a problem. 5 hours and 9 minutes on a desert course, mm-hmm. you know, an easy golf course where everybody's shooting in the 60s for the last group. And I'm not blaming the last group because they were held up. I mean, that's my point is, and it's threesomes. I get that. It's not twosomes on the West Coast because they got to finish by 7 o'clock Eastern time. And I don't know why, but they do. But that's ridiculous. Hmm. That's, you know, my rule in golf as a player is once I get into the fifth hour, past 4 hours, I'm not enjoying it anymore. And there's no reason. And the other interesting thing is if you talk to rules officials on the tour, when they put someone on the clock, you know, when the group's falling behind or whatever, almost without fail, the guys play better because they're not overthinking. They're great players. They know how to play. They don't need to examine every shot from 14 angles. Step up and hit the damn ball. And, you know, there are plenty of examples of great players who were very slow, Jack Nicklaus being the most prominent. Tiger Woods has always been slow, not slow like Nicklaus, but slow. But there are also examples of great players being very fast. Tom Watson is very fast. Tom Kite was very fast. Lanny Watkins. Rory McIlroy is very fast. So somewhere, you know, Mark Russell, who's just now retiring as the tournament director, once said to me, the problem is we have on tour, we got guys who want to play at 70 miles an hour. We got guys who want to play at 40 miles an hour. Well, enforce the rules. The rules are there. Enforce the rules to the point where everybody can at least go 55.
John, how mad is your guy Barry Trotz this morning? His trip back to D.C. did not go well. A few nights ago, they allow the goal with under 30 seconds left to Justin Schultz to give the win to the Caps. And then last night, just fritter away a three-goal lead. Caps explode in the second period. So the trip to down to D.C.
And that's with no Ovechkin, you might.
John's just as pissed as Trotzy is.
Yeah, probably I am, because Trotz is a lot cooler head than I am. That's why he's a coach. I mean, last night was just ridiculous. I mean, it's like you said, they didn't fritter away a lead. They just collapsed. 5 goals in one period?
Yeah.
I mean, they were terrible. Now, you know, Lou Lamoriello is obviously a great general manager. I mean, he won 3 Stanley Cups for the Devils. He rebuilt the Islanders when he took over. They were terrible. They were in the conference finals last year. But I thought he made a mistake, you know, and I'm not second-guessing. I thought it at the time when he let Thomas Greiss go, because one of their strengths last year was they had a good goaltender every night, and they didn't have to wear their guys out. You know, if Varlamov had a bad game, Greiss came in. Greiss had a bad game, Varlamov came in. They don't have that anymore. And Varlamov's been good. The backup's been terrible. And they've got some other issues, too. A couple of guys, you know, the Caps, when they won in 2018, they had the stars, but they also had those third and fourth line guys, those third defense group guys who were very solid. There was no place where you looked and said, oh, they're not good there. They were solid. And that's what Lou's always done, is had teams that were very solid through the third and fourth lines. They're not right now. And they're not going to make the playoffs. I mean, that division is the division of death anyway. There are good teams. I mean, I'm not sure there's a bad team in the division, except maybe the Rangers, because they average, you know, their average age is like 14. But they're not going to make the top four in this division for sure.
The next two games for Washington will be a good test because they play Boston.
Play the Bruins, right. Right.
And
again,
good.
They're going to play the Bruins are good. The Flyers are good. Not sure about the Penguins. I'm not sure about the Devils. Washington is good. It's a very solid division. Any of the four teams that make the playoffs could come out of that division because, you know, they're going to play each other the first two rounds.
It's going to be weird, and we were bringing this up earlier, since they're only playing each other eight times, they're not playing any other team through 56
right.
games. And then once they do play them, you hadn't seen them. I know you've seen them in other years, but you hadn't seen them this year. That's going to be strange.
It'll be strange, but you know what? In a way, it'll be fun. It'll be sort of like the old days in the World Series where the League had never hadn't played the American League at all. And if you were a National League fan, you didn't know much about the American League team or vice versa. And it'll sort of be like that with the last two rounds this year, because one team will come out of each of the four divisions. I mean, it feels like the Canadian teams are playing in another side of the earth. I haven't signed up for the hockey package yet. I have to do that. It's such a pain, but I will do that this weekend.
By the way,
it this week because I knew I'd see both Islander games against the Caps.
How weird was it the other day, I don't know, 4 or 5 days ago, when the Vegas Golden Knights, the entire coaching staff got COVID, or so they were quarantined, and the GM coached them?
Yeah, yeah. Nice. That's someone who's very familiar with us in this town,
yep.
George McPhee.
Nuts.
A lot of times, hockey is different than other sports in that a lot of times the GMs are ex-players. It's not true anymore. I mean, there's still some left like Ozzie Newsome, but it's not so much true anymore in other sports, and certainly not baseball, where they've all gone to Yale Business School. But George McPhee played in the National Hockey League for a long time. In fact, he quickly, one of the great stories he told me years ago, he was playing for the Rangers. With Herb Brooks was the coach when the Islanders were king. And he was one of those, you know, guys who was sent out to light people up and things. And so Brooks turns to him in the first period. He says, when you get out on the ice, I want you to go start a fight with Clark Gillies. Gillies was arguably the greatest fighter in the history of the NHL. He was the one who ruined Dave Schultz's career just by pummeling him. So Brooks, doing what he's told, he goes over and, you know, shoves Gillies as hard as he can and drops the gloves. And he said Gillies laughed at him and just skated away. I'm not going to fight you. And so he goes back to the bench and Brooks says, what happened? He said, he wouldn't fight me. So Brooks says, okay, go out and fight Nystrom. And George said, unfortunately, Nystrom was willing to fight me.
It's just the way it is.
Those were the days.
Real quick, as we talk to John Feinstein, best-selling author, Washington Post columnist, if you were running the Washington Wizards, what do you do with Bradley Beal?
Boy, it's a great question. I don't think, you know, he's 27 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He's a great player. Everybody understands his frustration. I mean, they're playing without a bunch of guys now. Unfortunately, Thomas Bryant's out for the season. That's too bad because he was getting better. But I think you keep him and you build around him. I don't think, you know, when you trade and you say, okay, I can get two first-round draft picks, you don't know who those first-round draft picks are. That's why somebody asked the question the other day in New York, would you, if you were the Jets, would you trade the number two pick in the draft and another pick or whatever to get Deshaun Watson? Of course, because Deshaun Watson's a sure thing. The number two pick in the draft isn't. They drafted Sam Darnold with the number three pick in the draft. So I would keep Beal and build around him. And he's a guy, when you're out trying to attract free agents, who people are going to want to play with. Because not only because he's a great player, but because he's a good guy. And I don't think you can get enough to make it worthwhile to trade Bradley Beal. The other thing, though, is that you have to consider is his contract is up after next season. So you better, if you can't get something going, because he's not going to come back and play if he thinks they're going to be a lottery team for another 3 years. then you might be forced to make a move. But if you can keep him, I would keep him. He's a great player. He's a good guy. He's the leader of the team. And he's only 27.
Well, but it kind of depends on what he wants. You know, these superstars are forcing their way out of their
They are.